Hey, welcome to Church Experience. Thank you so much for spending part of your weekend with us. Now's a great time to grab your pens and weeklies and head to your seats if you haven't already, because the service starts in 90 seconds.
Welcome to CE Online. We are so happy to see you today, and I'm looking forward to today's impacting message. During the service, you may have some questions, comments, prayer requests. If so, go to churchexperience.tv.connect or pull out your camera app and scan the QR code to connect with us. Or you can even hit that subscribe button if you've always wanted to know more about what's going on here at CE.
We're always glad to hear from you, get back to you, and be praying for you. Can you guess what time it is? Time to spend some time worshiping God through songs. Let's jump in, participate, and let God speak to us during this time.
Step out of the shadows, step out of the grave, break into the wild. Don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces. Grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you were, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here.
Cannot survive when we pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you. Lord, we are so grateful to get to praise you, Lord. And just remind us that we can use that praise as a weapon. You gave us that praise to conquer anxieties, to fight our worries, to use that when we are feeling low, when we're feeling far from you, Lord. We can use that praise as a weapon just to call on your name, Lord, to restore us, to refresh us, to renew us. And we are so thankful for that. And it's in your mighty name we pray. Amen.
The charts this week, single soon by Selena Gomez.
I'm picking out this dress, trying on these shoes, cause I'll be single soon. I'll be single soon. I know he'll be a mess.
Well, welcome to the final week of Top of the Charts 2023. And man, I've been loving this series. Every single week, we've been taking one of the Billboard Hot 100 songs, and we've been looking at those lyrics. We've been breaking them down, the good messages and the bad messages. And every week, we've been filtering those lyrics through the lens of God's Word. And we've been pointing back to Jesus. And man, we've been learning a lot. Well, I'm really excited about this week. This song that you just heard performed, Single Soon, is by Selena Gomez. It's a great jam. It was just released on August 25th of this year, and it peaked at number 19 on the Hot 100, top 100 songs in our country right now. Now, this song is still solidly on the charts, and people are still singing this song. But if you question this song and how popular it is, you just got to check this out. On September 14, this song was temporarily removed from streaming services. And look what this fan wrote. They put this on X, formerly Twitter. They said, "Single Soon has been removed from Spotify. I think it's the worst day of my life." Are you kidding me? That's how loved this song is by some people. Man, they removed it. It's the worst day of my life. Right, now, the theme of this song, Single Soon, is obviously about singleness, about dating, about leaving and getting back in the game again. And you know, there's a lot of couples in the room today, and I know that. There's some married couples. There's people, you came with somebody today. And I know that there's somebody that got an elbow while that song was being performed, right? Because the person next to you was whispering to you, "Hey, this song ain't for you. Quit singing." But even though many of you in the room today are not single, this song is for you as well. Now, we have a lot of singles in our church, but this song is relevant to all of us because, as you can see on this graph right here, singleness over the last 30 years has been on the rise in our country. And marriage is on the decline. And the number of couples that are living together is on the increase. And there's been this breakdown of God's plan in family and God's plan in relationship, and we're seeing the evidence of that. We're seeing the fruit of that throughout our culture. And so because we're surrounded by people who are single, right? There's single people in this room. There's single people in your family. All your kids, they're going to be single before they ever get married if they do. And look, everybody who is married, you were once single, right? So this is a topic that touches all of us. And in the Bible, it doesn't tell us that being single is a bad thing. There's some people that think it's a bad thing, and they despise it. They hate being single. They just can't wait to be with somebody. But I want you to kind of reframe your perspective on it and what God wants to accomplish in that season of being single. So if you're here today and you're not with somebody, look, God's got a purpose for you, and we're going to talk about that. But we're also going to talk about marriage today as well and how to make a relationship last, right? Because we don't want to be in a relationship singing that song, "I'm about to be single soon. You're looking for the exit." Look, we don't want that. We want it to last. And so we're going to talk about singleness. We're going to talk about marriage. God's got a lot for us today. And we're going to begin in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. We always want to look to God's word, not man's word, on how to operate our relationships. because God's ways are always better than our ways, even when we don't understand it. We trust in the Lord and in His ways, and He will direct our paths. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, beginning in verse 32. It says, I would like you to be free from concern. An unmarried man is concerned about the Lord's affairs, how he can please the Lord. But a married man is concerned about the affairs of this world, how he can please his wife. And his interests are divided. An unmarried woman or virgin is concerned about the Lord's affairs. Her aim is to be devoted to the Lord in both body and spirit. But a married woman is concerned about the affairs of this world, how she can please her husband. I am saying this for your own good, not to restrict you, but that you may live in a right way in an undivided devotion to the Lord. If anyone is worried that he might not be acting honorably toward the virgin he is engaged to, and if his passions are too strong and he feels he ought to marry, he should do as he wants. He is not sinning. They should get married. But the man who has settled the matter in his own mind, who is under no compulsion, but has control over his own will, and who has made up his mind not to marry the virgin, this man also does the right thing. So then, he who marries the virgin does right, but he who does not marry her does better. A woman is bound to her husband as long as he lives. But if her husband dies, she is free to marry anyone she wishes. But he must belong to the Lord. In my judgment, she is happier if she stays as she is, and I think I too have the Spirit of God. It's really interesting kind of reading through this text about being single, because some people look at being single and they despise it. They think this is a terrible thing. I don't want to be single. Maybe sometimes thinking, well, something must be wrong with me because I'm not with somebody. And what's interesting here is it's telling us that to be single is actually a really good thing. And here Paul is making a case, you know what? And in a lot of ways, being single might even be better for you, because when you're single, you have an undivided heart. You're not worried about the complexities of you know, maintaining all these other things in family and all that, and you can just focus on the Lord. And in that season, while you are single, and it might just be a season, instead of trying to rush out of it because you're so busy looking around trying to find the next somebody, maybe you should get busier looking up to the Lord and say, I want to get closer to the Lord. I want to have that undivided heart, which we should all have. But again, it gets more complex when your life gets more complex and you add family and all that. And so it's not saying you can't have an undivided heart when you're married. Of course, we should have our heart fully for the Lord. It's what it's saying, though, practically, is you're busy trying to also care for and give affection to your spouse and love them well. When you're single, you do have other people you love in your life. You do still have family and friends, but in a different kind of way, it's you and the Lord, and you have this undivided focus. And so what I'm saying is, in the season of being single, it's actually a gift. It may not feel like a gift if you're all ready to be married and you're looking for that person, you haven't been able to find them. That can be frustrating, right? But here's the thing. In that season, while you're in it, focus on the good that can come out of the challenges. And for some, they're like, I'm content. I'm not even looking for somebody. But whether you're hungry and you're ready to be married, or whether you're like, man, I'm just content where I am. Either way, what you have in this season is you have a gift, right? And the gift is that focus on the Lord with an undivided heart. And this is what it's telling us here in this scripture passage. It's also telling us that we can be content in that season. We can learn with God's help, right, to be content. We think of being content when it comes to our riches and our wealth, right? To be content and trust in the Lord with what you have. And that's certainly a form of contentment. And the Apostle Paul wrote in another place in Scripture, he said, you know, I've learned to be content in every situation, right? And part of being content in every situation is learning that God can help you be content even when you're single. He can help you in your singleness to find contentment in Him if you will trust in Him, rely on Him, pursue His presence in prayer and in worship, draw closer to the Lord, and He'll help you find your purpose in the singleness. Now look, there is purpose, and this is part of the message. If you have single people in your family that you're caring for, loving on, raising up, single people in your friend network, here's the message to them if they're in the Lord. You need to say, hey, Jesus has purpose for you even in this season. When they're leaning on your shoulder and they're feeling weak or lonely and like, I want what you have or whatever it is, like, this is a message for them, is to say, look, you can have tremendous purpose in the Lord in this season of singleness. In fact, let me just give you an example. Acts chapter 21. Check out these single ladies. All right, all the single ladies in the house, this one's for you. All right, Acts chapter 21. Check it out, verse 8. Leaving the next day, we reached Caesarea, and we stayed at the house of Philip, the evangelist, one of the seven. He had four unmarried daughters. He had four single daughters who prophesied. Now, I love that. I love that. These young single women, they spoke on behalf of God. Prophesy means to speak on behalf of God. They're speaking, sharing a word from God, and they're giving this message as young single women. And I love that. While they were single, they still had a purpose to rep Jesus. They wanted to rep Jesus to the culture. They wanted to speak on behalf of him. And what I'm saying to you is you have a tremendous opportunity in your singleness. You can be in places, in environments, and in different ways that you can't when you're married. You have a distinct opportunity. You have a unique opportunity, a gift to, in your singleness, honor Jesus and speak in a certain way and live in a certain way that can give glory to Jesus. And you can have a purpose even while you're being single. You don't have to wait till you get married to live out your purpose. Look, I found some single people think, well, it's only when I get married one day. It's only when I have family. My purpose is to have kids. My purpose is to raise children. Look, I hope that is. I mean, that's great. That's a blessing to God. He wants godly offspring. He wants children. But here's the thing. Like, he has a purpose in you that's not a less than purpose than your friend who is married with kids. Right? I mean, he has a purpose for you to speak on behalf of Jesus into the culture now in your singleness. And you have a powerful platform to do that. So it's all about getting synced up with the Lord and his purpose in the season that you're in right now, married or single. I was kind of looking around the house the other day, and I had my earbuds in, and I had been listening to the music, but all of a sudden I heard in my earbuds this cartoon show or something was started playing. It was like a kid's show. I was like, what's up? And so I started looking around the house, and I look over in the other room, and my youngest daughter had her tablet up, and she was watching this kid's show, and she had this confused look on her face, like, why is there no volume? It's because the Bluetooth and my earbuds picked up her show. And so I'm streaming into my earbuds instead of my music now. It's her show. And so I got synced up with her and what she's watching, right? And here's the thing. Part of being single is getting synced up with what God's purpose is for you in that season, not the next season, because it's so easy to get our minds looking outside of our current context and thinking, well, I want to be over there one day. I want to get into that next situation. I can't wait to see who that next person's going to be in my life. But here's the thing. God has a purpose he wants you to get synced up with right here, right now, and he wants you to hear his voice clearly. He wants you to get connected to him. He wants a strong signal between his voice and you. And perhaps part of God's purpose for you in this season is for you to get to hear his voice in a way that you've never heard it before. Getting into his word and into worship with that undivided heart, with that pure focus on the Lord, not distracted by all the other things, not distracted by the chase. But instead of looking around, you're looking to him and saying, Jesus, in this time, in this moment in my life, I'm going to seek you with this reckless abandon. I'm going to look up to you and trust that God, as I look to you and I care about what matters to you, you're going to help care about what matters to me. And if what matters to you is being with somebody one day, you can trust that God can help point you to that person. But it's in every season in our life, we want to find God's purpose and get synced up with that. Here's how I put it in your notes. God has a special purpose for me in every season. Marriage, being single, raising children, raising grandkids, and watching them through the unexpected things that happen in your life that God already knew were going to happen. Some of you today, you're single, and you never thought you would be single again. But something happened, something you didn't expect happened, and now you're finding yourself single again. Look, God can redeem that. God can use that. God can minister to you and through you in this season, whether it was in your plans or not. God saw it coming. He already made a way. You just got to trust in him. Come on, church. Let's clap our hands like we believe that God has a purpose in this season. That's right. Come on. Clap your hands and say, God has a purpose. Yeah, come on. Say it again. God has a purpose. Yeah, he's got a purpose for us in this season that we're in. And part of the purpose is to get closer to the Lord in prayer. And it's not just praying about what we want in the next season. It's praying for God to help sustain us in our current situation with the current limitations and the current opportunities. And it doesn't mean that when you're single that you shouldn't look around. You should get in environments. If you're wanting to be with somebody, you should get in environments, but you need to protect the kind of environments you get in. Right, you don't want to be going out to the club looking for that special someone, because there's a real low chance you're going to find a person with high character if you go to a place that has really low morals, right? I mean, you want to be in an environment, you know, getting in. I love that we just started a new young adult group in the church. I love that. It's for 20-somethings. I love that that's going on for the young singles in our church. I love that we have all kinds of groups, that more groups than we've ever had in the history of our church. There's all these circles that you can get circled up with other people and build relationships in. It's good to gather in worship, to be around church. Nothing wrong with coming to a church looking around. It shouldn't be your reason to come if you're single, looking around trying to find somebody. But I would argue this is the best place to find somebody. It's where I found my wife. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that story in just a moment. But you know, we want to get in good environments where there's other people that are pursuing Jesus, and we all have our eyes on him. And in seeking him, sometimes God brings people together. So get yourself in good environments, but seek God first. Seek his presence first. Don't waste time in your singleness and compile up regrets because you don't have your eyes on God. You have your eyes on everywhere else around you. Song lyrics that we just heard from this song by Selena Gomez says, I'm a date who I wanna, stay out late if I wanna, I'm a do what I wanna do, I'll be single soon. And it's interesting to me how much this song is focused on a very self-centered context, self-centered orientation. Like, it's all about what I wanna do. I'm gonna be single. I'm gonna do what I wanna. I'm gonna date who I wanna. I'm gonna do whatever I wanna do. And a lot of people waste a lot of time because they're doing whatever they wanna do instead of trying to get focused on what God wants them to do. And in dating, it can be a trap. There can be a dangerous trap in dating when you're not doing it for the right purpose, when you're not doing it to seek the Lord and his will for the right person that you're gonna spend your life with. Instead, you're out just playing around, messing around, just to have fun. Now, you should have fun with your friends. You should go out with your friends. But the purpose of dating is to understand the kind of person and the specific person that one day you want to spend the rest of your life with. So when I was starting to date Jennifer the summer that we got together, it was actually a story before the story of how we got together. And what that was is I started to get to know Jen, and I realized, man, I really like this girl. There's a lot to her under the surface that I didn't know. And so I even said that to her later on in our relationship. I said, hey, as I got to know you, I realized how deep you were. And she said, you mean like you thought I was shallow when you first met me? I was like, no, I didn't mean it like that. I just meant the more I got to know you, I pulled back the layers and I realized, man, there's a lot to this girl that I really love and more than I even realized. But when that was starting to happen, I started to get to know her, and I was realizing that there was more to her. I got my interest in. We were living in San Diego at the time. I was working for her dad at the church that he pastored there in East County, San Diego. And we were young. We were like 19, and I was starting to fall in love with her. And so I asked her out. I kind of said, hey, will you go out? And she looked at me real candidly. We were friends, and she's like, hey, like I'm not the kind of person just to date for fun. She's like, I'm not doing that just for fun. But if you're serious, like marriage is an option in the future, then I'll date you. It doesn't mean we have to get married, obviously. But like if it's something that you're ready for, if you're ready for that kind of a relationship that could lead to marriage, then yeah, I'll go out. But if you're not, then no. So I said, what I said is like, well, I'm interested in you, but I don't know about that. So let me get back to you. So I exited, right? So like, I got to go pray about that. I'm not sure. That's pretty heavy. That's pretty serious. And so I'm kind of thinking about it. And I realized, you know what? No, I am ready. And that's the kind of girl that I want to be serious with. She raised the bar and I stepped up to it. This is the funny part. I came back the next day and I had a flower. I had some gifts for it. I said, all right, I'm ready. I'm ready to get serious. Will you go out with me? And she said, yes. And look, we've been together ever since then. I mean, we've been married 21 years. We dated 3 years. I mean, we've been together a long time. And 4 kids later, and I don't regret it for a second because, man, she called me out. Like, we're not just dating for fun. Like, we got to be serious if we're going to do this thing. And we had a lot of fun, but we were serious. Like, we were trying to figure out if this is the relationship God had for us to be married in. And here's what I say to you if you're single. Date for God's future, not just for your fun. It doesn't mean you can't have fun dating. It just means don't date just for fun. Date for God's future. Date with a future in mind. Because if you're just out there kind of messing around with a lot of people, look, that can mess you up in all kinds of ways. We're going to talk about that in a moment. But the lyric in this song that we just heard said, I know I'm a little high maintenance, but I'm worth a try. I know I'm a little high maintenance. And Selena, she's singing this. She's admitting it. She's like, I'm a little high maintenance, but I'm worth a try. You know, give me a try. Just try it out. Just experiment a little bit. Let's just have a little bit of fun. Like, let's just see how it goes. And what I would say to you in your singleness is, look, I mean, you might have to date a few people to find out the kind of person you fit with, to find the right person. There might be more than a few, but But out there just experimenting, just having fun, just messing around, not really serious, not really thinking about long-term relationship, just kind of looking for some short-term companionship, sleeping around. I mean, you can have all kinds of hurt and pain in your life by compromising your standards for the sake of fun. And there's a biblical concept of not being unequally yoked. And some of you who are believers in Jesus, I'm just going to kind of get in your business a little bit, okay? So don't take it personal. I'm actually trying to help you, not hurt you. But you're a Christian. You believe in Jesus. You've been following Jesus a long time. But you're out there dating people because you haven't found the right Christian guy or the right Christian girl yet. So you're like, you know, I'll date them and then I'll bring them to Jesus, right? I'll date them for a while. And if they're a good guy, then I'll bring them to church, right? And then maybe they'll get saved and it'll work out, you know? But look, this is not a good plan. God's word, not that it can't ever happen, but what I'm saying is it's not a good plan because God's word says do not be equally yoked. Don't be partnered together in that kind of a relationship with somebody who doesn't share your number one passion, which should be your greatest passion in your life, Jesus, pursuing him, loving him, living for him. They don't share that. So that means everything in your life is going to be second best. Now, you can have still a good relationship with somebody who doesn't love Jesus, but it's not going to be as good as it could be, right? Because they can't share the thing that's best in your life. Right, that's not the best thing for them. So everything is going to be second best. Right, you're gonna only be able to connect on things that are second best. My wife and I can pray together. We can share our faith together. We're going to heaven together. Like we have a lot of things. We're raising godly kids together. We're establishing a godly home together. We connect on that soul level, and it's allowed it to last and be deep because the thing that we both love more than each other, Jesus, we share that in common. You can't do that if you're partnering with somebody who doesn't love Jesus. And it's not just, because here's the thing, too. I've talked to a lot of single people, and they'll say things like, well, oh, yeah, they believe in God. Like, what church do they go to? Well, they don't go to church right now, but they believe in God. No, that's not what I'm talking about. You need to get somebody that loves Jesus, because the way that they handle their relationship with God is a good indicator, perhaps, of how they're going to handle their relationship with you. And they're not taking that real serious. There's a good chance they might not take you that serious either. Because what foundation are they building their commitment to you on? Because for me, the foundation I built my marriage on is it's a vow to God. It's a covenant relationship. It's not a contract. Man, contract, you can tear that thing up if it's not going well. If they're not meeting the terms and conditions that are good for you, if they're not benefiting, you just tear that thing up and move on to the next contract. Right? But if it's a covenant between you and God, right, that's a permanent thing. That's an all-in for the rest of my life kind of thing, right? And so you want to find somebody else who has that mutual commitment to God and his plans, that they're committed, they're covenanted before God and you, to you and to the marriage. You don't want them to treat that casually. But if they're treating God casually, like, well, I kind of go to church sometimes. I kind of pray every once in a while. Yeah, I hang with you. It's like, no, that's not what we're talking about. We're finding somebody who loves Jesus, and they're going to pray with you. They're going to love you. They're going to serve you because they serve Jesus. That's what you want to look for as a single person. Don't compromise your standards because you don't see what you want right in front of you right now. You trust that as you seek the Lord and you work on your life and you get yourself ready, that God is also getting that other person ready for you in the right time. Now, you can be single and confident on the one hand, or you can be single and dwell in discouragement and feelings of being unloved. So why is that? Why do we see single people that are confident and they feel good about life even though they're single, whether they want to be single or not? And then you find people who are single and they're discouraged and they're feeling lonely all the time and unloved. You can also find people who are single on the one hand and they are content and they're healthy and they're in Christ-centered community. And then you can find people who are single and they're lonely and they're dwelling in these feelings of being left out and being forgotten. Why do we see people who are single in like both of these groups and both of these categories? It's kind of interesting. And I think the difference maker, as I put some thought and study into this, is the difference maker is finding your strength and your comfort in God's presence through prayer and through worship, focusing your thoughts on and being confident in who he says you are, who he created you to be, the amazing future that you have in Christ, being focused on him and your relationship personally with the Lord. That's what gives you confidence. That's what gives you hope. That's where you find your value. But if your value is in some other person that you have yet to meet or find, then you're always going to feel like you're less value than somebody you see walking down the street and they're all holding hands and they're all like kissy faces and stuff. And you're like, man, I wish I had that. I must not be as valuable. But when you find your value in who God says you are, you find your value in who God made you to be, you're fearfully and wonderfully made, the scriptures say. God created you purposefully, intentionally, beautifully, and God sees such value in you that his son Jesus went to the cross for you to die for your sins. So he sees immense value in you. And whether you see it or not right now, when you look in the mirror, God sees it. And you've got to, in this season of singleness, find your value, fill up in Jesus. Find your value in him. And as you have a full heart, when you get into a relationship one day, right, when you start dating one day, if that's what happens in your life, you'll be able to be in a posture to give and not to take. Because you won't be going into that relationship like, I need something that I don't have. I need to take from you to fill up something that's lacking. You're going into that relationship like out of the abundance of feeling loved, you can love them even better. Now, you can love because you are loved. You can give them value. You can help them see their value in Christ because you have value in Christ and you know that. And so the difference maker is moving closer to the Lord in every season we're in, whether we're single or whether we're married. It's filling up our life so much with Jesus and letting that light shine inside of us. It's right. It's out of the overflow of the heart that the mouth speaks. So in your marriage, the words that are coming out, whether you're building up or tearing down, in that dating relationship, the kind of relationship you have, it's going to most often flow out of what's happening on a soul level inside of you. Interestingly, this song ends with a little statement. They're not even really singing it. It's just kind of like the fun ending of the song and talking about being single and moving on. And it's just this little line, well, who's next? Yeah, right. And so we kind of take that as you hear the song, like, okay, who's next? Swipe left onto the next person. Right. I tried that. That was a little fun, but now I'm moving on. And it's just like bouncing from one person to another. And unfortunately, this is kind of what's commonly accepted in our culture. Instead of long-term marriage and long-term relationships, it's like, I'm just going to try it a little bit. I'm going to try it out. I'm going to sleep around. We're going to get intimate. And if it doesn't work, that's fine. I'm going to move on. And there's a lot of problems with that from God's perspective. Because it's not best for you. And I just want to speak to that for a moment from Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4. Whether you're married or single, this applies. It says, marriage should be honored by all. You know, it's interesting, the things that God honors, the devil tries to tear apart, right? Like the devil tries to destroy. The things that God loves, the devil is trying to destroy because he's trying to get back at God. God threw him out of heaven because of his prideful heart. And so God threw him out of heaven. He's going to throw him in hell for all of eternity. So while he has the opportunity, he's trying to get back at God, and he's trying to attack God's kids. And he'd love to destroy your marriage. He'd love to destroy your faith. Anything that God cares about in your life, he'd love to destroy. And it's interesting when you look at our culture, no one is honoring marriage, not like it should be, and not like it used to be, and not like God's word says. I mean, marriage is not honored, right? It's like discarded. It's spoken about poorly. I mean, don't be that kind of person that talks terribly about marriage. You might be single, and maybe you're coming out of a bad relationship, but don't tear that down for others. I mean, you have kids that are hearing that. I mean, they could grow up and have a healthy marriage, and just because you married somebody who was a jerk to you and they betrayed you or whatever, that doesn't, and you may never get married again. I hope that God heals your heart. I hope you do, but don't dishonor what God honors, right? I mean, don't whatever season you're in, whether you're married and unhappy, married and happy, single and unhappy, heartbroken, or you're just excited about the future, whatever situation and season you're in, it tells us that we should honor marriage because it's honored by God. And it says marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. For God will judge the adulterer and all of the sexually immoral. It's telling us to honor God in our sexuality. God created sex. I mean, think about this. I mean, it's not something we shouldn't talk about, right? Because it's a gift from God. It's created by God, and it's meant to be enjoyed. God wants you to enjoy the gift of sex. Like, if anybody wants you to enjoy that, it's God, because he made it. Right? So why are we all ashamed and embarrassed about it? You know, it's like, no, God wants you to enjoy that. But he says it's to be honored in marriage, and the marriage bed kept pure, meaning there's one pure, one singular place where that should be enjoyed, that gift, according to God's word. Right? This is not man's word. It's not my opinion. It's not your opinion. It's not what you looked up on the internet. Like, this is God's written word. Right? It tells us that the sex should be enjoyed, the intimacy of sexuality should be enjoyed in the context of a man and a woman coming together in marriage as companions for life, not a short-term contract, but a long-term covenant. And in that special space that God has created, that sacred space of marriage, that covenant relationship, that intimacy should be enjoyed and ever deepened throughout the years as you serve one another in that way and you love each other in that way and connect with each other in that way. It's a special gift that God has created. And man, there's a lot that we could talk about in that topic. A lot we could talk about. We did a series one time called Oversexed and Underloved. I thought it was funny because some person was telling me about that series one time. They're like, yeah, I started attending the church when you guys did that one series called oversexed and underpaid. And I was like, no, that's not what we called it. We didn't call it underpaid. We said oversexed and underloved. You got that wrong. But there's a lot we could talk about. That's not a sex conversation today, but I do just want to linger on this point for just a moment, because I think in singleness, a lot of damage can be done when people sleep around and go from one person to another, and then they don't wait for marriage. They don't wait for that special somebody, right? Because God does have that gift plan for a person. If you're meant to be married, God has a person. He has that special gift that should be given one time. Now, when you give it out to everybody else, that stickiness and that connectivity, that intimacy, you lose that. It's kind of like if you imagine like a piece of tape that you keep sticking on something all around your house, and you keep unsticking it and sticking it back on. I mean, over time, it's not sticky anymore. But part of sexual intimacy is that connection, that deep intimacy between two people. And you keep giving that away to everybody that you sleep with and everybody you sleep around with. And what happens is, like, you didn't mean for it to happen that way. You thought you were going to be serious, and so you sleep with them before you got married, and then it didn't work out. And so you moved on, and you slept with the next person. Same thing, didn't work out, you moved on. It's by the time you actually meet that special someone, man, you got all that other stuff, like, running through your head, all that tape. You know, all those memories, all those comparisons, all those special moments that were shared that should have been saved for the... I mean, and so that connectivity, it's not that it can't happen, but it makes it a lot harder to fight through that stuff. In fact, even just moving in together, you saw that on the chart earlier. Let's put that chart up here again. You can see that. The people living together, that's actually increased a lot in these last 30 years, percentage-wise. But here's the thing. Living together, it's unwise, because it makes it difficult for you to discern if that is the person that you should marry. Because now if you decide, you know, maybe this might not be the person, now it's not a matter of should we actually keep dating or not. It's like, where am I going to live if I move out? Or how harsh is that going to be for me to kick them out? How am I even going to have that conversation? What am I going to do with all my stuff? How's this going to work? I mean, it just gets increasingly complicated. And so it's better to date while living in separate places. When you think it's time to get married, you get married and you go all in. All in with intimacy, all in living together. It's something special that you waited for. That's God's plan. My wife Jennifer is so cool. I mean, she was the homecoming queen of her high school in San Diego, and man, she had options, because she is a great girl. She's an amazing girl. She's a beautiful girl, and she was a homecoming queen. She had a lot of friends. She had options. She got asked out. She got asked to dances, different things, but she never dated anybody. In fact, I'm the only guy she's ever dated. I'm the only guy she's actually ever kissed. And I can carry that as an honor. But Jennifer, she decided, like, I'm gonna wait until I find the person that I want to marry before I start to date and get serious, and I'm not playing around. And she was blessed with the same thing I was, that when we were students in our student ministry, our student pastors, they had the courage to teach on something called True Love Waits. And they did this campaign. It was kind of big when we were in that era going through things. I mean, you might remember it, but it was this idea of, like, you know, true love waits for marriage. Don't sleep around, like, wait till you get married. And I'm glad that when I was single, and I'm speaking to you today, if you're single, like, I'm glad someone had the courage to share that message with me, to say, hey, wait, it's better. It's hard to wait, but it's worth waiting for. And we made a commitment. Maybe some of you, this is the weekend where God's calling you out, and he's calling you to make a commitment. And I'm so glad that we made that commitment and we kept that commitment. And we didn't sleep together until we were married. And it was hard. It was a hard 3 years. Like, we dated 2 years. We're engaged a year. It was hard to wait, because we wanted to be together in every sort of way, because we loved each other. But we waited. And it was worth the wait when we got married. And now, like, zoom out. Like, we've been married 21 years, okay? I mean, we've been living together and sleeping together. I know, TMI. I know, I get it. But we've been living together 21 years now, right? I mean, so that 3 years, as long as it felt in the moment, like, that doesn't even seem like that long at all right now. It's like, that, I don't even remember that. Like, I hardly remember all that waiting. But now I've been able to enjoy a healthy marriage for all these years because we waited. Now here's the thing. If you haven't waited, right, does that mean that you cannot have a healthy marriage and you can't be intimate one day with this special someone? That doesn't mean that at all. Like, God can restore, God can forgive, God can heal, all that. But you have to first decide to commit to God's plan. Like, you want God's blessing on your life. You want God's blessing on your marriage or your relationship, maybe with that person that you came with today and you're sitting by. You want God's blessing on that. Well, you have together got to decide that you're going to do it God's way. Here's how I put it in a statement. God's blessing on your plans comes from honoring his plans for your relationship. You want God's blessing on your home? Then you got to do it God's way. You want God's blessing on your relationship? Then you got to do it God's way. If you want God's blessing on your plans, you have got to honor his plans. Now, what happens when we don't follow through? Because we fail. We all fall short. You might be trying for that, but you failed. Look, God is gracious. When we repent, we change our mind and say, no, I don't want to live that way, God. I want to live your way. We turn our lives over to him. We pursue him. We ask for forgiveness, and we commit our way to him. Look, I mean, God will help you. I mean, that's the story of the gospel, that we all fell short, every one of us in the room. Like, we all have sinned and fall short. Whether your sin was sexual sin, or your sin was greed or pride, arrogance, stealing, slander, whatever it was. Like, we all have sinned. And it's not just one thing, by the way. We all have sinned, right? We all sinned in a lot of ways. But because God is rich in mercy, he saw us in our sin and didn't want us to perish for all of eternity and waste away in hell with the devil. He saw something better for our future. And so he sent his son Jesus to die on that cross for your sin. And when you look to him and you ask for forgiveness, he'll forgive you of everything you've ever done. Every sexual sin, every mistake in your life, every failure, he'll forgive you fully and completely. You just got to look to Jesus. He's done the work. You don't got to go do the work to clean yourself up. Like, you look to Jesus and he'll clean you on the inside. Now, you will have work to do on the outside. You will have to go to work and straighten some things up in your life. But you don't have to clean your life up to come to Jesus. You just come to Jesus in humility and say, I'm broken. I did it wrong. I got my plans all mixed up. I was focused on myself and my pleasures instead of God's purpose. But I'm coming to you now, God, and I'm asking for forgiveness, and he will forgive you. You come, and you ask for restoration. He'll restore you. It's what he does. He's that kind of God. God's blessing on your plans comes from honoring his plans in your life. I had one woman I knew that we're in church together, and she's a great person, a lot of fun. And she goes, you know, this whole idea about being single, I don't want to be single again, because I've spent all these years training my husband, and I don't want to have to start over. It's like, I've already trained him how to do it right. And she goes, and if he ever gets the idea to be single again and leave me, I'm going to bury him in the backyard. I thought that was pretty good. But this song lyric that kind of caught my attention, it said, you know, Selena sings, I know he'll be a mess when I break the news, but I'll be single soon. I'll be single soon. I know he'll be a mess when I break the news. You know, it's interesting because, you know, in long-term marriages and relationships, short-term marriages and relationships, whatever, you know, the idea is that both people are mutually committed, but sometimes that's not the case. One person is committed, but their commitment exceeds the commitment of the other person. The other person is kind of looking around. Whether they're not doing anything about it or not, they're kind of discontent. And they're looking around for greener grass, which, by the way, I heard it said this way, the grass is always greener where you water it, right? It's where you put your attention. It's where you put your focus. It's where you put your mind. But in this song, Selena's saying, yeah, I know it's going to be a mess. I know he's going to be a mess. I know this is going to break his heart, but it's fine. I'm going to still do what I want. I'm going to be single soon. I'm going to date who I want. It's like this me focus. And following Jesus in our life, there's part of this idea of in marriage is like, I'm surrendering what I want for what God wants and what he says is right. Take a look at this passage in Malachi chapter 2. Malachi chapter 2, verse 13. God's word says, another thing you do, you flood the Lord's altar with tears. You weep and wail because he no longer looks with favor on your offerings or accepts them with pleasure from your hands. You ask why? Why? It is because the Lord is the witness between you and the wife of your youth. You have been unfaithful to her, though she is your partner, the wife of your marriage covenant. Has not the one God made you? You belong to him in body and spirit. And what does the one God seek? Godly offspring. So be on your guard and do not be unfaithful to the wife of your youth. The man who hates and divorces his wife, says the Lord, the God of Israel, does violence to the one that he should protect, says the Lord Almighty. So be on your guard and do not be unfaithful. God is saying you do violence to the one that you should protect by leaving and making them single because you were after greener grass and you were looking for your own pleasures, what pleased you, and you're leaving a mess behind because you want to do it. It's a self-centered approach, and we know that way of living life focused on me and what I want is going to lead to brokenness. It's sin, and sin leads to death, the death of every good thing that you want in your life and in your future. Sin leads to death. You introduce it into your marriage, it'll destroy your marriage. You introduce sin into your business, it'll destroy your business. It's a cancer. And God is saying there's a better way because I have a vision for godly offspring, for unity, for friendship, for love, for family and future generations. I have a plan for you to be cared for and to love and to serve each other, to protect each other and to care for each other. But to rip apart what God has brought together, to separate what God has united, is doing violence to God's plan. It tells us in Mark chapter 10, do not separate what God has united. It tells us in 1 Corinthians in chapter 7, though, that there is a time where sometimes these relationships will separate. It tells us in 1 Corinthians 7 that a divorce is acceptable in God's eyes when an unbeliever abandons a believer. You did get unequally yoked, or maybe they walked away from their faith and they decided to walk away from you. Does that mean that you need to be single the rest of your life and just live in mourning and that you can't end that relationship when they left you and they're gone and maybe they're with somebody else or not, but they've completely abandoned you? It tells us in this passage in 1 Corinthians 7:15 that if you're abandoned, that's one of the reasons that sometimes someone who's married might be single again. Another one is in Matthew chapter 19, verse 9. It tells us that because of the sins of sexual immorality, if you're married to someone and they committed sins of sexual immorality, they cheated on you, whatever, and you decide to leave that relationship, it doesn't mean you should. It doesn't mean that that's necessarily the best. It doesn't mean God can't heal and forgive and restore and make it better than it ever was. But that's an acceptable terms for divorce according to Scripture, Matthew 19, 9. But instead, what God's plan for us is not for marriages to end in brokenness. There's one final lesson today, and I want to speak to marriage specifically. I want to speak to long-term relationships. It comes from Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. Take a look with me, if you will. This is God's plan of how it should work. All right, we're talking a little bit about when things go wrong, but look when it goes right. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. God has a plan to bring us together and unite us in a way that lasts, to love each other like Jesus loved us. And husbands, let me speak to you for a moment. How did Jesus love his church? He gave everything for her. It wasn't what he wanted. Do you remember right before he went to the cross? He said, Father, if there's another way, show me the way. But not my will be done, your will be done. And he gave up his life, went through painful execution to love the church. And what I'm saying to you is, what your calling is to love your bride, to die to yourself. That means when you get like this and you get locking heads on an issue, it's not like, well, it's my way or the highway. No, no, no. You're the first to die to yourself because Jesus died for you. That's your motivation. He gave everything for you. And when you were wrong, and she might be wrong, who knows, but you give up what you want. You sacrifice first. You surrender first. You serve first. You lead the way by loving and caring like Jesus did for you. It's a beautiful thing when it works right. And, you know, like I said before, they said that the grass is always greener where you water it. So let me ask you, here's the final question today. What relationships and thoughts need more water to grow in your life? Where do you need to water the relationships in your life? Where do you need to put more time and intentionality into it? Where have you let it drift? And as we talked about last week, it's depreciated because you've stopped appreciating. Where is it in your life that you need to allow God's word to water and grow up health in your life and relationship? I'd like to close the message this way before I pray for you. We had an opportunity to go on a date night a week or two ago, and we went to BJ's here locally in the Countryside Mall, and we were just having a good time just sitting at a booth. Now, it was kind of a little bit of a last-minute thing, and so we didn't get into getting a babysitter or whatever, and our kids are older, so we just put them on the other side of the restaurant. We walked in, we told the hostess, we're like, hey, we love our kids, we just don't want to see them, and so we put them on the other side of the restaurant, and we went on the other side of the restaurant, and we sit down, and we're having a date night. At the end of the date, at the end of the night, we go, and we're reunited with our kids, we're all going to go home, and one of my kids says, hey, my phone, it dropped down in the booth, beside the booth, and it's up against the wall, and I can't get it. And they'd taken the top off of the booth, and they're trying to get down there. We're like the last ones in the restaurant. We had stayed late talking, and so like we're the last ones there. And I'm like, oh, man, this is not what they want here at the restaurant. It's not what we want, but we can't get it out. So I go tell somebody, and they go get the manager of the restaurant, and they're like, hey, this has happened before. And the manager comes out, and she's got two things. She's got a spatula, and she's got this ring of spoons, long metal spoons on a ring, and there's a lock on it. I don't know why there's a lock on it, but they're all locked together. And she comes out, and she's like, I think I can get it. And I kindly tell her, well, I've already tried. And I show her the knives on the table that I tried to lift the phone out with, and I couldn't. I told her what I did. And I was like, I don't think we're going to be able to get off. I think we're going to have to unscrew that screw there. I might have to come back tomorrow and help. We might have to call somebody. And she's like, no, I think I can get it. Now, I should have faith. I'm a pastor, but I did not have faith, to be honest. I didn't think she was going to get it out. And she was digging around in there. She couldn't get out with a spatula. So she pulls a key out. And she goes over to the spoons. And she unlocks the long metal spoons. And she pulls a spoon out. And she starts bending the spoon with superhuman strength. I'm like, what's going on? And she puts that spoon down in there. And I'm like, man, she's wasting her time. I actually turned around. And I'm thinking, all right, we're going to get everybody together. We're going to leave. And I turn around to look at her. And she's holding the phone in her hand. And I couldn't believe it. I'm like, you did it. And I told her, I was honest, I'm like, I'm a pastor. I really should have believed in faith that you could do this. I'm a man of faith, but I didn't believe you could do it, but you did it. Thank you so much. And we had this fun moment, you know, celebrating what looked like was a lost cause. But she had the faith to not give up on it. And she dug down deep and pulled up something of value that was lost. And what I'm saying to you is you might feel lost in your situation. Lost in your singleness, lost in your past sins, whether the sexual sins or some of the brokenness in your life. You might feel lost in your relationship, like there's no hope. This is never going to get better. I don't know how we're going to get through this. I don't think it's going to work. I married the wrong person. Whatever it is, you may feel stuck right now and think there's no hope. But what I'm telling you is God is speaking today into your life saying, there is hope. Just have faith. Just trust in me. I can change things when you can't. I can change things when they won't, because I'm a God who does miracles. I'm a way maker. I'm a change agent. I can do whatever it is that you can't do. I can do it. With man it's impossible, but with God all things are possible. So listen today, lean in a little bit. Look, God has hope for you in your singleness. God has hope for you in your broken marriage. God has hope for you in your good marriage to make it great. God has hope for your great marriage to pass on to future generations the lessons you've learned. God can do so much if you'll just have faith. But you've got to trust his plan. So let me ask you today before I pray for you. Where is it in your plans that your plans have deviated from God's plans? How are you going to get that back on track? We know God's plans are better. It's not going to be easy. Where do you need to commit? Maybe you need to make a commitment that true love does wait. I'm going to wait until I get married before I sleep with somebody again. It's not going to happen whether you've slept with someone before or you're a virgin. It doesn't matter at this point. Right now what matters is your commitment. That's important, but what matters in this moment, the most important thing is your commitment now going forward. In your marriage, you've been kind of half in. You've been kind of looking around. You've been clicking on things you shouldn't. You've been flirting the way you shouldn't at work. Look, be all in. God has a better plan than the plan you're playing with. That's not going to lead to greener grasses. That's going to lead to brokenness and death. Be all in. God's got a better plan. So what is it today you need to surrender to the Lord? His plans are always better than our plans. Right on, church. Come on, right on. Let's pray. Father, I pray over our church family today. God, there's so many people represented here that are hurt from some of these issues we've talked about through their past mistakes, poor decisions, or the decisions of others that impacted their life. Maybe they're hurt today because they have people in their life, their children, maybe a parent, maybe someone in their life that's living currently in a way that's outside of your plans and it breaks their heart. But God, we bring before you all of our issues. We bring before you all of our loved ones. We bring before you our situation. And we just believe in faith that God, even though we might give up, even though we might feel like giving up and we don't see a way out, we feel stuck. God, we believe that God, you can make a way. And so I pray for that person who feels stuck in their singleness today. I pray for all the single people in our church, God, this weekend. I'm praying, God, that they'll find purpose. They might feel stuck and lonely and forgotten about and of little value, but God, remind them of their value in you. God, may they just right now receive that truth from your word, not what they think about it, not what they've heard their friends comment about it, but God, what you say. They're of infinite value. May they put their trust in you this weekend. And Father, we pray over the marriages in this church. God, not only the current marriages, but the future marriages, those who are dating, engaged, those who are planning on one day having a family. God, we pray over those marriages. It's a gift from you. It's a blessing. It's your plan for godly offspring. It's your plan for future generations. And so God, we pray for those marriages. You fill them with not only a sense of your presence, God, but give them a special intimacy in their marriage, a closeness, a love that they can't even understand. It's so good. It fills them with joy when they think about it. God, restore what's been broken. Heal the wounds. God, bring all things new. God, you can do what we can't do. And so, God, we're praying for healing. We're praying for grace. We're praying for love. And Father, I pray that your church, God, in this generation where marriage has been dishonored, where singleness is on the rise and people are discarding your commands in so many different ways, God, may your church be a radiant example of the beauty of what it looks like, Father, to be committed to your plans above our plans. What you have said is right and what we know we need, not what we feel like we want in the flesh. But God, what you've said is best for us. May we trust in you, and may you lead us and make our paths straight. Jesus, we love you so much, and we thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you mean for us today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Before our usher team comes forward to receive our tithes and offerings and response cards, here are a few important things happening with our CE family.
God's Word has so much wisdom to help us enjoy healthy relationships. In November, we're taking a deep dive on marriage, parenting, and friendships and how to honor God in these important relationships. Don't miss our upcoming teaching series, #fam. Push everything else on your calendar out of the way so you can prioritize gathering with your CE family for worship and a good word every Sunday in November. As our ushers come forward to collect our response cards and to receive our tithes and offerings, giving God the first fruits of your income is making a statement that God is first in your finances and first in your life. We give in response to all that he has given us and to further his kingdom in the world through his church. If you need help being consistent in returning the tithe to God, our giving website can help you by setting up an automatic recurring gift with each paycheck God provides. Because you are a faithful, generous church, God is using us together to see lives transformed every week.
Thank you for being on mission with us to help more people experience a full life in Jesus Christ.
Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will, and I choose to pray. And I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names, that nothing can stand against. So yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Joy when my heart is heavy.
been an amazing time here at CE with you. You may have made a commitment during the service today, and if so, we'd love to have you reach out and let us know by scanning the QR code. If you have any questions, comments, or prayer requests, you can scan that same code or go to churchexperience.tv/connect.
We hope to hear from you. If you haven't, check out our CE social media, Instagram, Facebook, website, or app. Make sure you do and go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I've loved our time together, and we can't wait to see you next week.